Welcome to today's Bible teaching with Pastor Mike Bernard of Shoreline Community Church in North Bend, Oregon. We hope you will be blessed as we explore the riches of God's Word verse by verse. Please open your Bible and join us for today's message. Here's Pastor Mike.
Our message today is going to be entitled An Introduction to the Book of Daniel. And it's been a long time that I've wanted to teach this book, and I can't wait. A lot of people have said that they're really exciting to get into this because it's an incredible book. In fact, many people end up calling this book the Book of Revelation of the Old Testament. And the prophecy in here is so accurate that many people have come to challenge whether this was even written back in by Daniel in the days of Daniel or whether it was written later on, because everything ended up coming true that's being written. And we've still got things to look ahead and see the coming of Messiah as well. But I don't know if you are the same way that I've been in the study of the Word of God. I love to study the Bible. And as I do, I go to different parts, but one of the areas that I always struggled in was in the area of the Old Testament. Now, it's easy to understand the historical books as we read, we see the historical narratives. It's easy to take a look at the poetical books that we have in the Bible. But when you get to the prophets, you start reading through the prophets and you think, what in the world are they talking about? And you get frustrated because you say, I don't get this. I don't understand it. Well, I took a course through the Moody Bible Institute. They did something that helped me out immensely. And what that is they broke down the Bible, the Old Testament in particular here, under structural divisions. And so I mentioned to you the Pentateuch, or the first five books of the Bible, and the historical books that we see. We've also got the poetical books, but we get into the prophetical books as well. Now, you get in there and you begin reading through and you say, that makes no sense. How do I apply this to my life? I don't understand even what I'm reading. And so often people end up getting frustrated and they put it down and they don't read all the way through the Old Testament. But what helped out immensely is to take these writers and to put them into the historical context so that you can see what is happening at that time. So what the Bible Institute did is they went ahead and they broke it up into three segments here. They broke it up into the pre-exilic books of the Bible, which means prior to 605 BC. And as we go through the book of Daniel, you're going to hear that date over and over again, 605 BC. It's an incredibly important date. But the books that were written before the Babylonian exile were Jonah, Amos, Hosea, Obadiah, Joel, Isaiah, Micah, Nahum, Zephaniah, Habakkuk, Jeremiah. You know, so often when we hear about the prophetical books in the Bible, they're divided into two major categories. And those two categories are the major prophets and the minor prophets. Does anybody know how that distinction is made, how that decision is made? It's crazy. The major prophets are the prophets that have longer books. The minor prophets are the prophets that have shorter books. And it doesn't help us do a thing to understand what's being spoken of. But when you divide it like this, so you take the prophetical books that are before 605 BC, the pre-exilic books, then you know most of those books are talking about the Assyrian captivity, the northern 10 tribes, even though they'll refer to what's going on with Babylon later on. But then the second group of books is called the exilic books, which cover the period from 605 BC to 535 BC. And were written during the Babylonian captivity. It makes a lot of sense as you're reading through and you realize it's the Babylonians that they're facing. And the final is over here, which is the post-exilic prophets, which write from 535 BC at the end of the Babylonian exile to 420 BC. And those books would include books like Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi. And it helps out a lot. You see, the book of Daniel covers a period from 605 BC to 535 BC. It's exactly 70 years, and I'll explain that to you in a little bit as we dive into that a little bit more. But the book is broken up into two separate segments. Each of the segments within the 12 chapters of Daniel are divided right in half. In fact, chapters 1 through 6 deal with the historical narrative of the events that took place. Chapters 7 through 12 deal with prophetic events, some of them which in our time have already taken place, some of them, particularly the return of the Messiah or the coming of the Messianic kingdom, are yet future and are apocalyptical in nature, or in other words, they're about the end times. As Daniel wrote his book, there were two major purposes in which he wrote it. Number one, to stress the God of Israel is sovereign over all, even over world governments. And that's really important for us to see today with some of the challenges that we're seeing around the world is that God is sovereign. But the second reason that Daniel wrote this book is to prophesy that a day will come when God will restore Israel under the government of their long-awaited Messiah, who we now know today as Jesus Christ, the Lord Jesus. During the day of Daniel, they were looking ahead to this future Messiah who would be coming. But the reign that's being spoken of isn't from the first advent or the first coming of Christ. It's the second coming in the kingdom at the end of the age that Daniel's looking ahead to. Now, I'm going to get a little more technical today than I normally do because I think it's really important that we understand the historical background of this book to be able to see how everything flows out and to be able to understand. So just bear with me if you would, and I'm hoping that this will make some sense to you. But the Nelson Study Bible breaks down the setting for the book in this way. In 626 BC, Nabopolassar became king of Babylon and altered the course of ancient history. He quickly overthrew the domination of the long-standing rival Assyria, and by the time of his death in 605 BC, he had eliminated the Assyrian Empire and swallowed it into what became known as the Neo-Babylonian or the Chaldean Empire. This course of events had significant implications for Judah, the surviving remnant of the nation of Israel. Judah had been largely under Assyrian domination since 670 BC, but now found itself serving a new master. In the same year as Nabopolassar's death, King Jehoiakim of Judah became a vassal of Nebuchadnezzar, the son of Nabopolassar. Nebuchadnezzar brought his father's empire to even greater heights, eventually deporting many of the Jews to Babylon. Daniel lives in the midst of these momentous events. Daniel was a close confidant to Nebuchadnezzar throughout the Babylonian king's reign. And so I think what's important to see here is that Nabopolassar, who had been the king of Babylon, had developed that empire to a point, and his son Nebuchadnezzar was off doing the battles. He was the commander of the army. But then suddenly he died. Nebuchadnezzar comes to the point in which he takes over and he begins to reign. And it was at the beginning of this reign that young Daniel and his friends, probably between the ages of 14 and 17 at the time, were taken into captivity. Now, I want you to stop and think about the trauma that must have gone on in the hearts of these young men. Here you've got the Babylonians who come and they take the finest of the young men. They take many of the younger girls, but I'm sure that many of the parents were killed as well. And it's very possible that Daniel and these three other young men had witnessed the execution or the death of their parents, much like we see going on in the Middle East today. Or at the very worst, they were separated from, or I should say at the very least, they were separated from them, and they were taken off over to Babylon as captives. Well, this book takes place during the Babylonian exile or the exilic period, and it covers exactly 70 years, and that's not a haphazard number. There's a reason for that number, and I'll get to that in just a little bit here. But look in your Bibles, if you would, to Daniel chapter 1, and I'm going to read just a little bit here. In fact, I'm going to ask if you would to please stand in honor of the reading of God's Word. And you'll see why I've brought some of the history in here as well. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand with some of the articles of the house of God, which he had carried to the land of Shinar, to the house of his God. And he brought the articles into the treasury of his God. Then the king instructed Ashpenaz, the master of his eunuchs, to bring some of the children of Israel and some of the king's descendants and some of the nobles, young men, in whom there was no blemish, but good-looking, gifted in all wisdom, possessing knowledge and quick to understand, who had ability to serve in the king's palace and who might teach the language, whom they might teach the language and the literature of the Chaldeans. And the king appointed for them daily provision of the delicacy that he drank and of training for them. Of that time, the king. Am I speaking out? I guess it's on now again. Sorry about that. Now, among those of the sons of Judah were Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. And to them, the chief of the eunuchs gave names. He gave Daniel the name Belshazzar, Hananiah Shadrach, Meshach, and to Azariah Abednego. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this word. And I can't think of a book in the Old Testament more exciting than the book of Daniel. I pray, Lord, that you would meet us here in our discussion. I pray that this book would jump alive for each and every one of us, that we might understand the principles that are being taught and apply them to our lives. We praise you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. In Daniel chapter 1, verse 1, it starts off this way. It says, "In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it." And once again, I said that year that this happened was in 605 B.C., and a brief history of the final kings in Judah may be helpful. In your handout in the bulletin, you'll see the entire list that's in there. But I just wanted to cover a few of the final kings in here so that you get an idea. If you remember, reforms took place under the reign of King Josiah, who reigned for about 31 years, but then he made a huge mistake, and he went to battle against Egypt. He went to battle against Necho, and he was killed. And so when he was killed, his son, Jehoaz, was put in office. And so he served for only 3 months. And unlike his father, who was a godly king, he was a very ungodly king. But he was removed and he was taken to Egypt at that point. And he's out of office. And so finally, we see that Pharaoh Necho places Jehoiakim in office, who's the king that we're looking at right now. Jehoiakim served for 11 years, and he was an incredibly wicked king. In fact, he was one of the most wicked of the kings. And then finally, he was removed from office in 598 through 597. Jehoiakim, his brother, ends up only 3 months in office, and then he's taken to Babylon. Now, Jehoiakim pops up later on in the scene after Nebuchadnezzar's dead, and we see another king of Babylon, Evil Merodach, comes along. And if you remember, there was one king that was taken and was allowed to eat at the table all of the delicacies. That was Jehoiakim. Jehoiakim continued on in Babylon. But what Nebuchadnezzar did is he went ahead and he took another son of Joash, or excuse me, of Josiah, and that son was Zedekiah, and he placed him in office for 11 years, and then at the end of that, Zedekiah rebels. His sons are murdered in front of him. You remember the story. His eyes are plucked out, and he's taken, and the last group of people are taken over to Babylon as well, and the Babylonian exile takes full force at that point. But as we look at these kings, unfortunately, Jehoiakim was not godly like his father. In fact, he was a very wicked king. When he was told things by God, he got very angry at the prophets who came before him. In fact, with the prophet Uriah, he had him killed. He wanted to have Jeremiah killed. He ends up doing something that's incredibly stupid as well. In Jeremiah chapter 36, verse 22 through 23, we see it says this, "Now, the king was sitting in the winter house in the ninth month, and the fire was burning on the hearth before him. And it happened when Jehudi had read 3 or 4 columns that the king cut it with the scribe's knife, and he cast it into the fire that was on the hearth until the scroll was consumed by fire." What happened here? God speaks to the prophet Nehemiah. He gives us this warning. You know, if you repent, then everything's going to be fine. If you don't repent, then you're going to go into captivity and all these horrible things are going to happen. And the scroll is brought to Jehoiakim. And as they're reading it, he says, "Give that to me." And he takes it from them, and he tears up the very word of God. That's the equivalent of taking the Bible and tearing up the Bible. And he goes over to the fireplace, and he throws it in. And of course, he burns it. And after that, things only got worse. Isn't that kind of that way in our own lives too? That when we hear the word of God and we begin to fight against God, things only get worse, that things go from bad to worse until finally we get it right and we start getting our lives right with God. Well, in 605 BC, the 70-year Babylonian captivity had officially begun. And the prophets had been warning the northern 10 tribes of Israel and the southern 2 tribes of Judah for years and years that this day would come if they didn't repent, and yet they wouldn't listen. And so in 722 BC, the 10 northern tribes were caught into captivity. They're taken away into captivity to Assyria, and they're gone. And that leaves the 2 southern tribes down at Judah, and you would think that that would be enough of a warning for them that they need to be right with God. They can't continue to live in sin. They can't continue to fight God. They'd been warned for years. Moses had started warning them all the way back in the Pentateuch, back in the book of Deuteronomy, in Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 1, when it says, "Now it shall come to pass that if you diligently obey the voice of the Lord your God to observe carefully all his commandments, which I command you today, that the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations." So the promise to Israel, and really the promise to us today too, if we're obedient, is if you obey God, he will bless you. And in the case of Israel, if you obey me, God says, I'm going to put you above all of the nations of the world. But as we look at Deuteronomy chapter 28, verses 58 and 63, it says this, "But if you do not carefully observe all of the words of this law that are written in this book, it shall be that just as the Lord rejoiced over you for doing good and multiply you, so the Lord will rejoice over you and destroy you and bring you to nothing, that you shall be plucked from off the land which you shall go." So right from the very beginning, God has said to Israel, if you obey me, you will be blessed. You'll go to the land. You'll have all of the promises. All these things are going to happen to you. But if you disobey me, you may be in the land, but you're going to lose all of that. And over again, the prophets have been prophesying that to him. Moses, Isaiah, Micah, Jeremiah, Habakkuk, and even this individual that Jehoiakim had killed, Uriah the prophet. One after another that come in, and even as I was just reading yesterday in the book of Jeremiah, even as Jeremiah is still prophesying to him, the promise is there is that if you repent, these things are not going to happen to you, that it's not too late for you to repent and get things right. And yet they wouldn't do that. Well, Jeremiah was a contemporary of Daniel. They were at the same time, writing at the same time, going through the same circumstances. In fact, even quoting each other at different times. But Jeremiah specifically promised that the captivity would be for a period of 70 years. Now, that captivity of 70 years isn't just a random number that was pulled out of the air. What had happened is that Israel had been commanded that on the Sabbath year or the seventh year, they were to give the land a period of rest. And then that would rejuvenate the land, and then they could go on for the next 6 years and give it a period of rest. For 490 years, Israel got greedy. They said, we don't need to take that Sabbath. In fact, we'll just continue planting, because if we take the Sabbath, then we're not going to be able to get our crops, and we want to get our crops. And so they kept on planting and planting 490 years. Now, what can we learn about the grace of God? Wow. They could have missed that first year, and God could have gone, squash, that's it. 490 years telling the people to repent, and they would not repent. And so finally, God had had enough. And when God had had enough of their sin, the hammer ended up falling. And so if you were to take 7 and divide that 7 into the 490 years in which they had violated the Sabbath, you come out with 70. And the number of 70 years captivity is going to be making up for all of those years that the people of Judah didn't follow that Sabbath. God brought the hammer down, and God got his Sabbath back, didn't he? And the people were forced off into captivity during that time. Well, in Jeremiah chapter 25, verses 8 and 9, it says this, "Therefore, thus says the Lord of hosts, because you have not heard my words, behold, I send and I take all the families of the north, says the Lord, and Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, my servant. Boy, have you ever thought about that? Isn't that kind of strange, reading this? Lord says, and Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, my servant, and will bring them against the land, against its inhabitants, against these nations all around, and will destroy them and make them an astonishment, a hissing, a perpetual desolations. In other words, what God is saying is, I have had enough. And at this point, I'm going to bring Nebuchadnezzar, my servant. Now, does that mean that Nebuchadnezzar was a godly man? Does that mean that Nebuchadnezzar was somebody who followed God with all of us? No. What we find out in the Bible so often is that when there is disobedience that goes on for quite a while and justice ends up coming, quite often that justice ends up coming by hostile nations. And in this particular case, Nebuchadnezzar was a hostile nation against Judah. And because of the sin of the nation, it was Nebuchadnezzar who was brought in to bring about the punishment that the nation would receive. And in 605, when all of this started happening, in that critical date, once again, the times of the Gentiles, and you remember Jesus referring to the times of the Gentiles, they began with the reign of Nebuchadnezzar in 605 BC. And they'll continue at this point until the return of the Messiah at the end of the age. In 605 BC, Nebuchadnezzar became the king of Babylon at the death of his father. Now, this is the starting point of the book of Daniel. Once again, 605 is that critical date. It's the starting point. But after the battle of Carchemish, which is located, it's an area that's located in what we would say in modern northwest Syria or in southeast Turkey, the battle that went on there, Nebuchadnezzar, he was the crown prince at the time. He was the commander of the Babylonian army, but Babylon established its dominance over Egypt and Assyria and in effect became a world power at that point. And so after the death of Nabopolassar, Nebuchadnezzar focuses on Judah and he heads on down to Judah against Jehoiakim, and Judah is taken captive at that point by him. And there's a series of three waves of people that end up going off into Babylonian captivity. In 605, they took the first group. That was the young men. That was the young ladies. It was those who had potential. It was those with royal blood. And we see that Daniel was among those young teens that were taken captive in the first wave of the captivity and forced to make the 500-plus mile journey to Babylon on foot. Think of what must have been going on in their minds with everything that was left behind in the past. And here they go. They are captives at this point. And they're on their way to Babylon. The second wave ended up occurring in 597 BC when 10,000 more captives were taken to Babylon in the second wave, including the 18-year-old King Jehoiakim at that point and also the prophet Ezekiel. So in the first wave in 605, Daniel goes, and we'll see his book. That's the book that we're studying. Another contemporary prophet was Ezekiel, and that's an incredible book as well. He was taken in that second wave at 597 BC, along with young King Jehoiakim, who would one day eat at the table of evil Merodach, king of Babylon, after Nebuchadnezzar. And then the third major wave of captives that was taken was in 586 BC, when Jerusalem was finally destroyed and the temple was burned. Warren Wiersbe says, "The fall of Jerusalem looked like the triumph of the pagan gods over the true God of Israel. Nebuchadnezzar burned the temple of God and even took the sacred furnishings, and he put them into the temple of his own God in Babylon. Later, Belshazzar would use those same holy vessels to praise his own gods at the pagan feast, and God would judge him." You remember the story back there. In fact, we'll see it in Daniel chapter 5 when it gets to the point in which Belshazzar is having that drunken feast and you've got the finger on the wall that's talking. And we find these very same vessels that were taken appear once again. Now, in these days, what the countries would think is if they conquered a particular nation, that meant that they conquered their God. And so they would take the vessels of the temples, the golden cups, and whatever else it might have been, maybe the golden lampstands, I don't know. They took the vessels there, and they end up bringing them to Babylon. But we'll see them come out once again with Belshazzar as he mocks God at that point, and God brings him down that very same day. We'll see these vessels pop up once again when Persia takes over. And Cyrus takes them and he sends them on back. And the vessels do end up coming back into the promised land. But I think it's important that when it seems like God is losing, don't you believe it for a moment. God is sovereign. And even in our own country, if we have bad things that are happening, or countries around the world, if there's bad things that are happening, God is not out of control. There's not information that we have to pass on to God. What we need to do is repent and get ourselves right. We need to be right with our God, and God will turn around and he'll bless those who are right with him. Verse 2, and the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand with some of the articles of the house of God, which were carried into the land of Shinar to the house of his God. And he brought the articles to the treasure house of his God. Shinar, by the way, you wonder, what in the world are you talking about Shinar? Well, I've got a map up here of the Babylonian Empire, and it kind of gives you an idea. Quite often, you see that when attacks come against Jerusalem, it's always talking, they're coming from the north. And so often today, people say, well, that means Russia's going to be doing the attacks in the final day. But what I want you to see is why they came from the north. Here's Babylon, and here's the area which is known as Babylonia. Shinar is another name for Babylon. In fact, it can also refer to the area below here, which is called Babylonia. But Babylon's about 60 miles south of the modern city today of Baghdad. And it gives you an idea. But what the people would do if they were to go straight from east to west, they've got to cover a massive desert. You've seen the pictures on the news. Very hostile for traveling. So the people would follow. They would go up here and they'd follow the Tigris River and the Euphrates River, whichever one they were close by. And then they would come down following the water supply as they came to Jerusalem. And that's why you see that the Bible says the enemies come from the north, because they always did come from the north. But here in Jerusalem, at this point, it began that 500-mile trek by foot that would bring the people over into Babylon. Well, the head god of the Babylonian pantheon was a god by the name of Bel or Marduk. And Bel, also called Marduk, was the sun god. Once again, in those days, they thought military victory meant that their gods were more powerful. David Jeremiah says it was not Nebuchadnezzar's military might or brilliance that brought about the downfall of Jerusalem. It was the sovereign will of God. Just as the Assyrians had been God's rod of anger against Israel in 722 BC, Babylon performed the same disciplinary action against Judah. Verses 3 and 4 say this. It says, then the king instructed Ashpenaz, who was the master of the eunuchs for Babylon. The king instructed Ashpenaz, we get his name, the master of the eunuchs, to bring some of the children of Israel, some of the king's descendants, some of the nobles, some young men in whom there is no blemish, but good-looking, gifted in all wisdom, possessing knowledge and quick to understand, who had the ability to serve in the king's palace and who they might teach language and the literature of the Chaldeans. You see that word Chaldeans, all that's telling you is that's talking about the Babylonians. But it's interesting that eunuchs were typically men who had been emasculated because they oversaw the royal harems, just so that there wouldn't be any problems. They'd put them through the emasculation on here. And it came with time to mean an important court official. So whether it necessarily meant that the individual was emasculated or whether it meant that the individual was an important court official, it could be taken either way. But some have speculated that Daniel and his friends had become eunuchs. And the reason that they speculated that is from Isaiah chapter 39, verse 7, where it says this, and they shall take away some of your sons who will descend from you, who you will beget. And they shall be eunuchs in the palace of the king of Babylon, which is exactly what we hear happening with Daniel and his friends. But possibly not. And the reason I say possibly not is because Daniel fought so hard to remain pure to the things of God. In Deuteronomy chapter 23, verse 1, Deuteronomy says, he who is emasculated by crushing or mutilation shall not enter into the assembly of the Lord. And so, you know, where some people are saying, well, Daniel went in here and he became emasculated. He became a eunuch, which is a possibility from Isaiah 39. But likely with the way that he reacts with the food and the wine and the other things, that may not have been the case, since anyone who was emasculated would become defiled and wouldn't be able to enter into the assembly of the Lord. Well, Nebuchadnezzar set up a three-year program to assimilate the captives into Babylonian culture. He would test them physically, intellectually, and socially. Why socially? Because if they were going to be in the palace, he wanted to know he had somebody really solid, and he didn't want them doing anything that would embarrass them. They likely studied agriculture and law, mathematics, history, astronomy, science, along with magic. And then they also had to study, even though the main language in Babylon was Aramaic, they also had to study the difficult Babylonian Akkadian language. In verse 5, it says, "And the king appointed them for a daily provision of the king's delicacies and of the wine which he drank, and 3 years of training for them, so that at the end of the time, they might end up serving the king of Babylon." Now, these young men are being educated in the arts, but there's a little bit of method to the madness that this king is going through. If you want to assimilate somebody into your culture, you don't give them the worst. You give them the best of your culture. You get them to the point in which they are totally dependent upon you. And so the offer for these young men to come in, I mean, you've got plenty of slaves that are in this kingdom, but now they're being offered the best of what the king's palace has to offer. And if all you got to do, Daniel, all you have to do, you know, for the other guys is just blend in. Don't make waves. You'll eat really well. You'll drink really well. Well, the ultimate purpose that they had here was to brainwash them into becoming Babylonians. And they're using this method in order to conform them and to get them away from their Jewish culture and their Jewish background. But guess what? It didn't work with Daniel. We'll see almost 60 years later when he's told that he cannot pray to his God. What does Daniel do? Immediately he goes in. Daniel points towards Jerusalem, and Daniel prays to his God. Daniel is committed to being pure in his walk with the Lord and wants to do what's right in God's eyes. Verses 6 and 7. "Now from among those of the sons of Judah were Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, Azariah, and to them the chief of the eunuchs gave the names. He gave Daniel the name Belteshazzar, to Hananiah Shadrach, to Mishael Meshach, and to Azariah Abednego." Even the name changes were intended to remove the young men from their cultural background and to assimilate them into the Babylonian culture. But notice what Nebuchadnezzar is doing and how he's trying to do some of this brainwashing. I mean, if you're going to change somebody's mind, if you're going to change somebody's culture, first thing you need to do is get their eyes off of their God. Get their eyes onto other things. Get their eyes onto the God of your particular land. And so what does he do? We see that he takes Daniel's name, and each of the names of these four Hebrews has the name of God or Yahweh worked into it in some way. So the name of Daniel means God is my judge. But Nebuchadnezzar had his name changed to Belteshazzar, which means Bel protect him. Who was the head of the pantheon of gods for the Babylonians? Bel. You see the switch that's going on there? Hananiah, whose name was Yahweh is gracious, that covenant name of Israel, is changed to Shadrach. Shadrach means under the command of Aku, which is another Babylonian god. Mishael, who is like God, his name is changed to Meshach, which means who is like Aku, or who is like the moon god. And Azariah, which means Yahweh, or the Lord has helped, is changed to Abednego, servant of Nego or Nebu. And who was the second most important of the Babylonian gods, and by the way, that was the god in charge of educations. Well, the name change was all part of the brainwashing scheme to assimilate them into the Babylonian culture. I wonder what somebody would think in our country if they went into a coma in the year 2005 and they woke up in 2015. Would it be the same nation that they went to sleep in? Or has this nation radically changed by the things that are going on? Is this nation radically changing by the barrage of instructions we're given that are contrary to God's word? It's amazing to look at the surveys from years ago and see where we stood as a nation, as more and more people were involved in Scripture, and then to watch those same surveys today as you see them flip-flopping. Why are they flip-flopping? Because all we're hearing from the media is, this is right, this is right, this is right. And we're being brainwashed, much in the same way here that you see that the Babylonians were brainwashing these young men. Today, only 4% of the kids in our country under 18 are being raised with Judeo-Christian values. And we see a calculated assimilation that's taking place into our culture. But watch how Daniel reacts. Verse 8, "But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's delicacies, nor with the wine which he drinks. Therefore he requested the chief of the eunuchs that he might defile himself." The king's food was the best in the land, but the wine was just superb. Why should they suffer? Why should they go through difficulties when they have all of these opportunities? But in the case of Daniel, Daniel purposed in his heart that he wanted to do what was right in God's eyes. He wanted to honor God. Daniel resolved not to eat the food or the drink, I think, for three reasons. Number one, the meat was unclean. It very well may have been pork or horse, and it would have violated the standards that are set in the Mosaic Law in Leviticus chapter 11. The meat had probably already been offered to the Babylonian gods and was defiled. And so that's a second reason that he may have said, look, I don't want to eat this meat. And a third reason is possibly that he might become too comfortable with the Babylonian culture and forget his own God. Are we in danger of doing that? I mean, do we go out and we just soak up all of the benefits of the culture until all of a sudden we get our eyes off of God and we begin to move away from him? And I think the same challenges that Daniel was going through in his day, we're facing many of the same challenges today. Daniel purposed in his heart to remain pure to God, and so should we. You know, and it's important that we do it ahead of time. It's important that we do it before the temptation ends up coming in. The place not to decide. I mean, you don't want to wait to decide that I want to be pure with God until you're in the back seat of your boyfriend or your girlfriend's car. That's not the time to do it. The time you do it is ahead of time, and you say, I'm not going to get myself into that situation. And if this happens, this is how I'm going to respond. And if we just go along in life with whatever happening without being focused on God, we're always in danger of being sucked into sin. But if we make up our mind ahead of time that we want to be obedient to God, and this is what I'm going to do, if that happens, Billy Graham, people were always trying to bring him down, but you know what he would do? If he was getting ready to get on an elevator, he'd stand by that elevator, the door would open up. If there was a single lady on that elevator, do you know what he would do? He would wait for the next one. Do you know why he would do that? Because there were people out there that were specifically trying to bring him down. He would have men with him when he went to his motel room. He wouldn't walk into that motel room first. Those men would walk in the motel room first and make sure that it wasn't a setup. And he decided ahead of time, this is what I'm going to do. And we look at Billy Graham today, and his testimony still holds even after 97 years. He took the standards. He made up his mind exactly what he was going to do. Well, verse 9 says, "Now God had brought Daniel into favor and goodwill with the chief of the eunuchs." I think it's important that we take a look and we see that it was God who ended up bringing Daniel into favor with the chief of the eunuchs. And notice that as Daniel is obedient to God, God is at work in his life. And the same is true for you, and the same is true for me. As we walk in obedience to God, God is at work in our lives, working behind the scenes, bringing things into order within our lives. If we're not walking in obedience, we're not getting that help from God. Verse 10, "And the chief of the eunuchs said to Daniel, 'I fear my lord, the king, who has appointed your food and drink. Why should he see your faces looking worse than the young men who are your age? Then you would endanger my head before the king.'" How's the chief eunuch reacts? He reacts in fear. "Daniel, don't you realize what you're asking me to do? If I take you off of the diet that the king has set you on, if you begin to lose weight and not look as healthy, my head is on the chopping block." And that's something big to ask anyone, literally, if they're going to put their head on the chopping block. And yet, that's exactly what Daniel goes ahead, and Daniel does that. Verses 11 through 13. "So Daniel said to the steward, whom the chief of the eunuchs had set over him." He goes to the chief. The chief says, "Daniel, you're asking me to put my head on the chopping block. Uh-uh." What's Daniel do? He goes a step down. He goes down to the steward of the chief, and he begins to talk to him. The steward of the chief of eunuchs who had set over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, and he says, please test your servants for 10 days and let them give us vegetables to eat and water to drink, and then let our appearance be examined before you and the appearance of the young men who eat the portion of the king's delicacies. As you see fit, so deal with your servants. How did Daniel deal with this whole situation? Did he get furious when the chief said no? Did he tell the guys, pull out your guns? Did he rally the troops? No. What he did is he continued to stay cool, and he continued to talk to people, knowing that God would do something. He worked from within. So he goes to Ashpenaz's steward, and he begins to talk to him. And what he says to him, in effect, is he says, let me prove my way, and the way of my God is better. And the results end up being conclusive. Somehow, Ashpenaz's servant or steward ends up allowing him to go ahead and do it. And at the end of that time, we find that Daniel and his friends are looking fatter, the Bible says. And I thought that was a strange thing to say, that they're looking fatter when they're eating vegetables instead of the meats and the wines and everything else. And I think what's happened here is that God supernaturally, even with less calories, enabled them to look better and bigger and stronger than the others. You see, it wasn't the vegetables and the water. It was the vegetables, the water, and God. We're to be in the world, but we're not to be of the world. In other words, we're not to be assimilated as Christians into the world system. We're pilgrims. We're only passing through. Paul wrote in Romans chapter 12, verse 2, do not conform any longer to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. In other words, we're to remain faithful to God no matter what it is that we're going through in life and no matter where it is that we find ourselves in life. Like Daniel, we're to be transformers. We're not to be conformers. You see, there's a difference. Daniel wouldn't conform to what they wanted him to conform to, but according to the word of God, he was transforming anywhere he went. And anywhere Daniel went, there was blessings that seemed to follow. Verses 14 through 16, so he consented. This is talking about the steward with this matter, and he tested them 10 days. And at the end of the 10 days, their features appeared better and fatter in flesh than all of the young men who had ate the portion of the king's delicacies. Thus the steward took away their portion of delicacies and the wine that they were to drink, and he gave them vegetables. You know, the chief official steward, Ashpenaz's steward, must have acted on his own here, because he did take that offer, and he did literally put his head on the chopping block. And that was blessed here. He put his life on the line for Daniel, and we see that things turned out supernaturally in Daniel and the others' favors. Verse 17, as for these four men, God gave them knowledge and skill in all literature and wisdom, and Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. Did you notice that it wasn't that they developed it on their own? Did you notice that it was God who had given them this? You see, what you have, what abilities and skills you have, are God's gift to you. But what you do with those skills and abilities that God has blessed you with are your gifts to God. Are you using the spiritual gifts that God has given you? Are you using those abilities to build people up and for the glory of God? Well, verse 18, it says, now at the end of the days, when the king had said they should be brought in, the chief priests of the eunuchs brought them in before Nebuchadnezzar. Wow. Think about all these young guys. These are teens, 14 through 17 years old. They're there for 3 years. So at this point, I guess they're 17 through 20 years old. And when it comes time for the final test of all of the education that they've been going through, they don't go to their teacher. They end up having to go to King Nebuchadnezzar. Can you imagine stepping before this evil king who was a murderer? And now you're going to be tested on the things that you've been studying for the last few years. Are you going to pass? Is he going to get mad at you? Is he going to go ahead and kill you? In fact, you look at Nebuchadnezzar. Why would he do this? Because he wanted to choose his own aides. If he was going to get somebody that was going to get close to him, he wanted to quiz them. He wanted to make sure that he knew that they would be faithful to him. Wonder how these teens would have felt, but we find out that they did fantastic. Because it says here in verses 19 through 20, then the king interviewed them, and among them all, none was found like Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Therefore, they served before the king. And in all matters of wisdom and understanding about which the king examined them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and astrologers who were in all of his realm. We hear that term, 10 times better. That mean they were exactly 10 times better? No, what's happening here is we have an exaggeration that's going on, a hyperbole, which is saying these guys did fantastic. They were so far above and beyond the others. Because you see, the teen's wisdom was tempered by their love for God and their love for his word. And it should be the same for us today, shouldn't it? The way that we react, the things that we do should be guided and tempered by our love for God, our love for his word. Warren Wiersbe says there's no reason why Christian students on secular campuses today shouldn't be among the finest students who win some of the highest awards to the glory of God. Church Father Tertullian didn't think that Jerusalem should have anything to do with Athens. But if believers from Jerusalem don't witness to unbelievers in Athens, how will these lost sinners ever hear about Jesus Christ? Amen. Going into all the world includes going into pagan campuses and letting our lights shine. The point is that even the Apostle Paul studied. In fact, he was very studied. He used his study and he used his learning in order to bring people to Christ by quoting their own writers, bringing them in, and Epimenides and others, and sharing some of the poetry work they did to make a biblical point. But through all the difficulties in Daniel's life, and he went through many, God developed his character. And God's doing that for you today, too. I don't know what each of you are going through in your life. Some of you I do, others I don't. But I know this, that whatever it is that you're going through in your life right now, God is developing your character. You are today who you are because of, number one, the experiences that you've been through in your life, and number two, how you responded to those experiences. And so Daniel ends up going through some really difficult times, but his character is being developed. And we see in verse 21, it says, thus Daniel continued until the first year of King Cyrus, which was actually 539 BC. Or in other words, if Daniel was originally taken in 605, for 66 years, Daniel has officially served in the capacity of being a counselor to kings, and literally eventually becoming prime minister of Persia. You see, everywhere Daniel went, he rose to the top like cream. In a humble and a gracious way, Daniel stood fast for God in an ungodly world. Are you willing to stand fast for God in the world in which we live today? The Moody Bible Commentary says Daniel's successful ministry is also evident of the length of his service. He lived to see the end of the exile, serving Babylonian kings until the first year of King Cyrus in 539 BC, king of Persia. Once the Persian Empire conquered the Babylonians, Daniel continued as a counselor to the Persian king, resulting in more than 70 years of service. In other words, if Daniel were 15 years old, let's just guess that he was around 15 when he was originally taken into captive. By the time we see this last verse, 21, in chapter 1, Daniel would be 83 years of age. And he served faithfully through at least five kings during that period, rising up to the position of prime minister. You see, God uses in great ways those who faithfully love and serve him. We've seen this many times in the Bible. Number one, God sent Joseph to Egypt, and he made him the prime minister of the land, putting him in the second highest position. Number two, God placed Moses right into the household of Pharaoh, and he received the education of the Egyptians. He was being prepared for his long-term ministry through the circumstances of his life. Number three, God made Esther the queen of Persia, and we see that Mordecai eventually became the prime minister of Persia, and the lives of the Jews were spared during the Jewish festival of Purim and through the events that happened within this book. Number four, we see that God placed Nehemiah into the position of being the king's cupbearer, to have his ear, so that when Jerusalem was in so much trouble and the wall needed to be rebuilt, that Nehemiah was there at just the right position, at just the right time. Have you ever had that in your life where you look back and you see that the circumstances just worked out right at that exact moment for what needed to be done, and you can see God working behind the scenes in your life? In number six, we see that God placed Daniel in the position of advisor to at least four, possibly five kings, eventually towards the end of his life, becoming the prime minister of Persia. Well, what can we learn from these six examples that we just looked at? Number one is that God honors those who honor him. Are you honoring God with your life today? Is he number one in your life? You know, as we look at our lives, God should be number one. Our spouses should be number two. Our children should be number three. Everything else should be down the line. And isn't it interesting how things seem to reverse so often and we get our focus that God is to be number one. And if God is to be number one in our life, and if we're to be right with God, then we need to get our lives right with others. And as we do honor God with our lives, he honors us and he blesses us. The second lesson that we can learn from these six nations is all of these nations were powerful, but God is sovereign over nations and even mighty nations like Babylon. And I'll say even mighty nations like the United States of America, that even today when it seems like more and more we're moving away from what God would have us to be and do, in fact, God is sovereign, he's in charge, there's no surprises. He's calling us to repentance as a nation, as Christians. Any changes that are going to take place in this nation need to begin with us. Well, Daniel lived in a time that was filled with ungodliness and with governments that were hostile to God. Yet look at how Daniel did it. He worked from within the system, and he made a huge impact. In fact, we're still feeling that impact today. But there's an important point that we need to see. As godly as Daniel was, with the ways that God had used him so specially, God never took Daniel out of Babylon. Daniel had to stay within Babylon. He had to work within that system all the way through until the end of the captivity. Well, what kind of influence are you having on your culture? I've got to ask you this question. Are you a conformer? Are you conforming to the culture around us? Or are you a transformer? Are you changing that culture around by being a representative of God and his word? Let's pray. Lord, we thank you so much for this book of Daniel, and there's so much in this first chapter as we've begun. And I pray that in this day and age, that each of us would rise up to be Daniels in our generation, that we would stand for what is fast, we would stand for what is true. Lord, that we would seek to be more like Jesus and share the light of Christ with others. Lord, if there's anyone here today, though, who's never received Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord, I pray, Lord, that they might repent, that they might turn, that they might just pray a prayer like this. Lord Jesus, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God. I believe that you died on the cross for my sins. I ask you to forgive me of my sins, cleanse me of all unrighteousness. Lord, come into my heart and life. Help me to be the kind of man, woman, boy, or girl that you desire for me to be. This day, I surrender my life to you. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Lead me to the cross where your